Talking about Extinction Rebellion and the protests that have shut down the centre of London now since Monday, and according to one of their spokespersons, they will continue indefinitely until their demands are met. And the question really is whether this is the right way to go about it. Are these demonstrations the right way to bring across the message that most of us would agree with, that we're in big trouble, that the planet's in big trouble, or are they counterproductive? So call me. Lots of you already have. I'm trying to get to as many callers as possible. We will continue talking about this after 11 o'clock, but do call. Our next guest here in the studio is Tom Burke. He's the chairman and founding director of E3G, an independent climate change think tank and former government advisor on climate change. Good morning, Tom.
Morning, Matt.
Are these protests going to achieve something that is not being achieved already, if it is, by the likes of Sir David Attenborough or Mark Carney?
They've already achieved something, which is to change the public conversation. They've transformed it. I mean, in a sense, it's
the protesters.
The protesters have, yes. I mean,
but in a bad way. I mean, we don't know. A lot of people are calling into the programme saying, why are they shutting down the centre of London? I was all, you know, in agreement with them, and now they've prevented me from going shopping in Oxford Street. How dare they?
No, you can't make any change for that irritating somebody, so I'm not surprised you've had callers on that. But what they've really managed to do is... Mark Carney has now been talking about climate change as one of the serious, most serious threats to the global economy since 2015. Mm. And this is really the first time people are starting to hear that's about the fact that central bankers have been involved for a long time, that this is not some passing sort of environmental problem. This is a really serious existential problem, which is what Extinction Rebellion are trying to make clear. So I think they've made a real difference to the conversation. And as Father Gormley was saying, you know, conversations are really important. Money makes the world go round. When you ask what makes the money go round, it's conversations. And if you want the money to go round differently, you have to have a different conversation.
Oops. Don't have that conversation right now. So turn your phone off. Thank you.
I've turned
Thank
it
you,
off.
Tom. Very good. So the fact, so we shouldn't actually see what you're saying is the protesters differently to Mark Carney, or indeed, other, you know, senior politicians or, you know, CEOs talking about climate change. It's all part of a package.
I think that's exactly right. We've got a very big opera here. There are many different parts of people to play in it. This is one and a very important part in that great opera of how we actually turn around what we're doing on climate change, which is far too little.
Okay, so why are we doing so little? We know periodically we get very upset by big climate events, you know, especially weather events, you know, floods, icebergs melting, you know, the threats of extinction to certain species. Why is that not enough to galvanise us into the kind of sacrifices that we need to make?
Because we've had a complete failure of the political class to take the issue seriously, to work out different political solutions and approaches to it for a considerable length of time. A part of the political class denying there was a problem at all. And in a sense, people respond to a lead. And if they're not given a lead by our political leaders, you can't be surprised when they don't respond very well.
So you were a government advisor.
Yeah.
To whom?
I was government advisor to Michael Heseltine and Michael Howard and John Gummer.
Okay. And did they take you seriously?
Yes, they did.
Anything about it?
They did lots of things about it. Did they do enough to address this problem? No. Michael Howard, surprisingly, was actually instrumental in making sure we actually got the framework convention on climate change, which was the start of a serious global effort to do something about the problem.
And why do you think politicians like to kick this problem down the line into the long grass?
Because I think all the real problems about making the change are political problems. We have the technology we need to address this problem now. We're going to have a lot more in the future. We know we won't ruin the economy. I actually make the economy a lot better, but we really will change the pattern of winners and losers, and we'll have to change it very fast and very dramatically, and that's very scary to politicians.
What needs to happen right now to make a difference?
Right now,
in terms of how we live our lives?
Yeah, right now to make a difference. Actually, the first, most important, cheapest, quickest thing you could do to deal with climate change is bring all our buildings in this country up to EPC standard A or B. We could do that very quickly. We drive down energy bills for people. We would actually reduce the burden of fuel poverty on the health service as well as dealing with climate change. So we could do something like that right away. There's no need to wait until 2025 or whenever it is the government said to make all future houses completely carbon neutral. We could start doing that right now.
But we're not hearing enough about that, are we? I mean, how it can be done, how you can help, how government can help.
No, there needs to be a lot more of that in the conversation. Right. I completely agree. We need a completely different role for our cities, and they need to have the fiscal freedom to play the role that they're best able to play because they're close to where people are and where people live. We've now got a lot of cities where there's already a political commitment to becoming carbon neutral, to getting their emissions down, but frankly, the over-centralization of decision-making in this country has stopped them from doing the kind of experimentation and mobilization of the community that they're best placed to do. So there are lots of things we could do.
So should this be a mixture of subsidies, you know, to increase taxes, penalties? What's the mix here?
I think it's a mix of all of those. I think subsidies can go down a bit. I think we should have a small carbon tax. But actually, the real reason for a small carbon tax is to raise revenues, because if you're going to have change on this scale, you're going to need a labour policy, so you do something with the people who will lose their jobs and train people to take up the jobs that are coming on board. We're going to have a much stronger industrial policy, social policy if you like, because some parts of the country will suffer more, other parts of the countries will gain. So you're going to need revenues to do that, and that's why you need a carbon tax. So you need to get rid of bad ideas. It's real waste of time and money and intellectual resources is to try to build more nuclear power stations.
We get to callers in a minute, but we saw President Macron in France, who has a similar view of the need for climate change to be addressed seriously as you do, try to raise the petrol tax, and what did he get? The gilets jaunes burning down Paris.
So, no, that's why I say it's a failure of the political class. If you don't explain...
What could he have said rightly that wouldn't have triggered these demonstrations?
I can't say what Macron said. I don't know enough about French politics. No. But I can say that what you have to do here is don't spring it as a surprise on people. You haven't given a lead to
explain,
them.
Explain.
Explain. And educate. And lead, which is the role of politicians in this sort of thing. And very clearly, be clear what you're going to do with the money. Because a carbon tax that's genuine will self-sunset as you drive carbon out of the economy, so the tax yield will go down.
Now, you came up with an interesting analogy in the break about how we should view climate change.
Yeah, climate change is a disease in a way, like a planetary disease, like diabetes. Now, diabetes, when you get it, has no symptoms. You don't know you've got it. It's a progressive disease, so it gets worse as long as you don't do things about it. By the time symptoms emerge, you've already gone past the best point to be, and if you start dealing with it then, you've got some chance of continuing to live a decent life. But if you go on past those points, disease gets worse and worse. It's exactly like climate change. If we don't do things now, then we make it much more difficult to deal with the climate we'll actually have in 20 years' time.
Okay, Tom, stay here because we've got some callers, and I'd like you to respond to them. John in Islington. John, you're on the air.
Hi. Just like to say, I'm not a sceptic. I'm a don't know, like the vast tens of millions of us. But I'd like to ask the question, are these the same scientists who, the United Nations top environmental scientists, who said exactly the same thing now, and in 1989, when they said in 10 years we'd be in trouble, that vast tracts of land, that in 30 years, which would be now, the temperature would have gone up to 7 degrees higher. It's all turned to be nonsense. So is this a new set of scientists or the old scientists repeating it? Because what they put out very, very strongly, much more dire than Attenborough or somebody else, much more dire consequences in 1989, 30 years ago. So could you tell me...
Let Tom answer that question.
I don't know the scientists you're referring to. Were scientists in 1988 in particular, when Jim Hansen first made his evidence to Congress, were they saying how bad it could get? Yes, they were, and they were right. And what's more, by and large, the scientists have always underestimated how quickly things would change and how badly it would get.
Okay. All right, John, I hope that answers your question. Let's go to Jack in Guildford. Jack, you're on the air.
Good morning. I just wonder why these protesters aren't protesting outside the Indian High Commission, the Chinese Embassy and the American Embassy. I mean, your expert there talks about taxing us. I move cars for a living, and there's a major shift away from diesel to petrol.
Okay, we're running out of time in this hour, so thanks, Chad. That's a really good question. Tom?
No, I think it would be a very good idea if they did demonstrate outside of those embassies. I think your point is a very well-made point. It's not just about us and what we do in Britain. It's about what has to happen everywhere.
Okay. Tom, that's good. Jack, thanks. Tom, just one final question, and very briefly, if you could. You made that analogy with diabetes. Are we at the point where if we change our lifestyles drastically, we can actually stave off the disease?
We can't, like diabetes, it never cures, but can we keep the world with a climate that we can manage to retain civilization in? Yes, we can, but not for very much longer if we
How
go
many
on
years?
At this rate. I'd say we've got probably a decade and a half, maybe 2 decades, to get, if we got to zero carbon emissions by the middle of the century, we'd have done enough to retain a manageable climate.
Tom Burke, thank you very much indeed for coming on the programme.